Hello, my name is Alexander Madry, and what I want to talk about today is the aspect of machine learning, in particular in the context of computer vision, that we might not be thinking that much about currently, but I think we need to pay much more attention to moving forward. And this is joint work with my students and Jacob Steinhardt. Okay, so the point of start here is just a quick look at what we view now as machine learning research pipeline. So usually the setup is as follows. So we have some data set, let's say ImageNet. And then what we are trying to do, well, we are trying to train a model on this data set, or at least at the training set part of this data set. And then once we have the model, we evaluate its performance by measuring its test accuracy, essentially the performance on the unseen, previously unseen part of this data set. Okay, so that's kind of the basic setup. Of course, you know, this is not how it really works. You know, there is also the feedback loop. So based on whatever performance we get, we might, you know, make some observations and based on that refine our training method and get a new model, and then we refine it back. And essentially, like, but this is how much of machine learning progressed, in particular, much of machine learning in the context of computer vision progressed. Okay, so this is the framework. However, the question I want to start is like, with which one I want to start is like, what are we usually concerned about where we kind of look at this pipeline and we apply it? Well, one of the most obvious worries is this danger of overfitting. So essentially our worry is, since essentially, well, we are training the model on one, this training set part of the, you know, of the data set. Now, a priori, we might worry that the whatever performance the model we attain on this training set might not carry forward to this unseen test. In particular, like the worry here is that maybe what our model is doing is just memorizing the training data, like memorizing the answer for the training set, but it's not extracting some, you know, deeper classification method that actually would allow us to perform well on the test. And you know, as you all know, this is a study of like decades of research by now. And I think we, you know, made a lot of progress here, although we still, in context of deep learning, are far from being done here. So that's concern number one. The concern number two is actually a bit more subtle. Okay, so what it says is saying that beyond just the question of overfitting, there is also just this question of adaptive overfitting. Essentially, the part that, you know, if you look at this kind of feedback loop, well, there is some feedback in which we refine our model based on the performance on this of our model on this test set. So in some ways, after one loop of iteration already, this test set is not truly unseen. And one could essentially worry that, you know, because that's how we improve our models and we always keep the same test set as a measure of progress, we might end up overfitting to this test set. Essentially, we are maybe kind of, this can be an, you know, an equivalent of thing called p-hacking in, that is a danger in sciences in general. Okay, and this is much a more recent concern in context of machine learning, but definitely we already spent some time on it and try to understand why or why this not be the true, but definitely this is a concern that we still need to, you know, fully understand and make sure we control. Okay, so these are probably the two concerns that people tend to worry about nowadays. But what I would like to focus on now is actually a third concern. In some ways, you know, something that, again, we implicitly think about, but we don't think consciously enough to actually properly control for it. And kind of the realization here is that, you know, as much as we got accustomed to this view that there is a data set, then we train the model on the data set and we evaluate on the test set, the reality is that this data set is not given, like it did not fall from heaven for us. You know, actually this data set came from somewhere and it was created with some intention in mind. Essentially, like usually this data set is supposed to be a benchmark for a particular real world task, let's say object recognition. And the important thing is that, like, yeah, this data set is just a proxy. It's meant to be a proxy for the real world task. And in particular, the question is, you know, is this proxy benchmark, you know, well, it never will be capturing the, you know, the diversity of the motivating real world task ever. So the question is that if we focus our attention on just improving this particular benchmark, aren't we actually overfitting to this whole benchmark? Okay, and that's something I want us to ponder a bit in the talk today. Okay, so in particular, the question I want to ask is, you know, how well our data sets reflect the real world? So this means, you know, what data set biases do models pick up? And how are these biases introduced? And by biases, I just mean things that kind of you know, might be true in the universe of benchmark, that like these are kind of some kind of usually correlations that, you know, the model might find helpful to perform well on the benchmarks, but not actually might not be something that holds for this broader motivating real world task that you are trying to solve. Okay, so this is kind of the motivating question for much of what we will be talking about today. And kind of just to make it more concrete, I think it's useful to start with a very simple example of a bias, namely the background bias, namely the fact that, you know, usually when we talk about, you know, data sets for computer visions, computer vision, in particular ImageNet, we have kind of the setup that there is like a, let's call it the main foreground object, and then there is a background. And of course, you know, they are all fused together. And essentially, the question is, you know, like the background bias refers to the question of like how much is the classification of a model actually reliant on the background as opposed to solely on the foreground object that is actually supposed to be like focusing on and classifying correctly. Okay, so I guess the first question to ask here to study this bias is just to ask, okay, do backgrounds contain signal to begin with? Like, is there even a point to pay attention to the background if we just care about the foreground? And, you know, the answer in short is yes. So essentially, what you can do, you can essentially train the model solely on background. So like, you know, without actually ever showing it any of the foreground objects. And then, you know, you can test it on, you know, either also a background only data set or on the original like a test set, and it will actually perform pretty well. So it's clear that there is signal in backgrounds, you know, and actually models are able to extract it when, at least when they are asked to do that. And, you know, this might be shocking, but probably isn't, and it's definitely not new, because kind of we knew that before. First of all, humans can and do rely on background. Like, if you see your work colleagues on holidays, like it will take you longer to recognize who they are. And again, there is like countless of papers by now that essentially study this effect. So there's kind of not like, just the question is like, you know, does background contain signal? And do our models actually, you know, like depend on this? You know, the answer is yes. And again, there is this is not a novel realization. However, what we wanted to do in a recent paper with my students is just wanted to get a bit more fine-grained understanding of the extent of this dependence and essentially, you know, where this dependence is coming from. So to this end, we essentially created a bunch of different versions of kind of a like, well, subset of ImageNet. And essentially, like, this different variation corresponds to, you know, playing with, you know, maybe like one variant is that you just only have the foreground, you know, foreground images, you completely separate backgrounds. The other ones corresponds to essentially like superimposing, you know, backgrounds from a different image, you know, maybe from the same class, maybe from random class, you know, like there are different variations with the foreground object, and essentially seeing how does it impact the performance of the model. And again, I don't want to go too much in depth here, like you can look at the paper for more details, but, you know, one realization is that in general, models, again, do rely on, you know, on the backgrounds, and actually, like, whenever you start messing with it, model accuracy is, it gets reduced, you know, and, you know, depending on the extent of this messing with backgrounds, you know, this drop might be larger or smaller. And but in particular, one finding that we kind of was somewhat surprising to us is that it's not only that the models kind of pay attention to backgrounds, they tend to pay attention to them to the extent that actually there's a notion of adversarial backgrounds. So essentially, for a large fraction of images, so over like, you know, 85%, you know, you can, you are able to reliably find a background that, you know, the foreground object superimposed on this background ends up with incorrect classification. In fact, it's even worse. It's that, like, even there are a particular background that tends to fool many of the, you know, many of the models on many of the foreground objects. Essentially, like, so they are kind of very confused, like adversarial backgrounds in terms of, you know, being almost oblivious to the foreground. So my, like, here are some examples, and my favorite one is the one in, you know, in bottom left, where you have someone holding, you know, something like that, and then, you know, it seems that whenever the model sees such a, you know, such a background, then no matter what is the foreground object you show, they believe this is a fish, even though there is no fish in this picture ostensibly, but you can, of course, imagine why the kind of model has tendency to do that. Okay, so there is, this is kind of definitely not the, you know, level of not the level of dependence on the background that actually you would expect or hope for. And you of course might ask, you know, okay, how can you get more background robust models? You know, in some way, you know, this is simply enough bias that it's not too difficult to do that. You know, you can just show that, you know, even just randomizing the background, so essentially training the model on, you know, foreground objects with random backgrounds, already helps a lot. You know, of course, it also costs you in terms of base accuracy because the signal from the backgrounds is lost now and the model cannot really rely on it. But, you know, it will definitely, like, it improves the background robustness quite a bit. And also what we found is that, you know, we are asked, okay, so like, as our, like, as we make more and more progress, let's say on the image net accuracy, so we get better architectures, better model, better training techniques to get like better and better image net accuracy, we were curious, okay, how does this, you know, background robustness evolve over time? And what we find, and this is kind of in some ways it's encouraging, we found that, you know, the more recent architecture, the architectures that are more successful on ImageNet tend to also be background robust. Interestingly, it doesn't mean they rely on backgrounds less. They actually rely on backgrounds more, but the way they rely on them seems to not make them still confused by the adversarial backgrounds. So kind of they pay attention to backgrounds, but they kind of pay attention in smart enough way to actually not be fooled when the background kind of seems to, you know, like otherwise would mislead. Okay? So this is kind of just an example of like the kind of biases we would be interested in and kind of what you can try to, what kind of questions you could ask about it. But actually what, you know, I would like to talk about now is essentially like a bit more nuanced kind of and more less obvious versions of the bias. Okay, so in particular, you know, essentially like I just wanted to signal some of the biases that, you know, exist because of the way our, like I would say, machine learning pipeline is designed. And again, at first you might not even realize they are there and they actually seem to matter. Okay, so what do I mean by that? So essentially, so the point of start is are just these three images and three labels for them. So these are like images from ImageNet, and these are like, you know, valid class labels from ImageNet. And essentially, if I show you these three images and these three labels, you know, they, you know, as far as you could probably tell, unless you, you know, you are, you know, kind of an expert in dogs, you know, they just look totally fine to you. Like they look like just, you know, a correctly classified images from ImageNet. However, what if you actually would look at the correct ImageNet labels of, you know, of this, for these images, you realize that, yeah, like all of the labels that were shown first are actually wrong. And the correct labels are, you know, the one that you see now on the screen. And again, on one hand, you might say, well, you know, our top one ImageNet accuracy is not great. You know, that's one lesson to draw here. But then you might say, well, you know, kind of maybe we are wrong, but like, are we really? Again, unless you are an expert, you know, you are a kinology expert, you know, you would not know, you know, what kind of exact breed of a dog this is in the picture. And for the other two pictures, like you really could argue, you know, that this is a church and that definitely there is an acoustic guitar in this picture. So kind of you could probably take some issue with like being incorrect on these images. And essentially, like this is kind of, you know, this is the kind of realization that led us to some of the work that we will be talking about in a moment, is that like, yeah, so where's really wrong, like kind of who was wrong here? Like, was it us or was it actually ImageNet? And kind of start to wonder, okay, actually, like, what does ground truth for ImageNet model even would look like and kind of how it is decided? Okay, so essentially like, so let's talk about this and kind of let's try to understand, you know, where is this, you know, correct labeling for a given ImageNet image, for example, actually decided? Like how does this process work? And essentially like, so how our datasets, like our large scale datasets created? And kind of usually when we think about dataset creation, like we tend to have this idealized kind of pipeline in mind, in which we say, okay, someone goes out there, sources a large, you know, amount of, you know, high quality real world images. Then there is an expert annotator who looks at each of these images and chooses the perfect, you know, the most proper, the right a category to label the image with. Okay, so that's how we think about that. That's kind of the conceptually, that's why we like to think about the process of labeling this, you know, these images and sourcing the data set. But like, if you think about this for a moment, you realize that this will, like, if that's how it worked, it would really not scale easily to millions of images, like, which is the size of the data sets that we are dealing with right now. In particular, you know, ImageNet has like 1,000 classes. So like expecting a human to be able to deftly navigate it and figure out the perfect class among 1,000 of them, that's already difficult. And then again, multiply it times, you know, millions of images right now. So this would not scale. And indeed, that's not how our data sets like ImageNet are being created, like have been created. And what actually happened is something a bit different that kind of tries to reverse the way labels and images appear. So essentially the way, the data sets like ImageNet were created is just by starting not with sourcing of the images, but actually with, you know, with selecting even what will be the class hierarchy, like class structure that you want to have. So actually, what is the classes that you actually want to have? So for ImageNet, this labels the hierarchy comes from the WordNet hierarchy, is derived from WordNet hierarchy. And then once we know what are the classes we care about, well, then if you want to find, you know, like images of that correspond to one label, let's say golden retriever, what we do is as well, we just go to like Flickr or we go to Google image search and we kind of find all the images that we get if we enter this, you know, this class as a like as a phrase, as a search phrase. Like you also look at, you know, maybe do it in different languages, you look at some variation of it, but kind of this is the basic idea that you kind of go there, you enter what is the class you're looking for, and you look for images that the search engines will provide you with. And of course, you know, you can't really like blindly trust the search engine. So what you do is there is a validation set, like cross-site validation set, in which essentially what you do is like kind of once you, for like this, you know, label golden retriever, you have an image, like one of the images that was returned by the search engine. What you do is like to validate it, you just like present this image, like to a human and ask, you know, does this image contain an object of class golden retriever? And you do it, you know, to like a couple of times to different humans. And if, you know, in like large enough fraction of them says yes, then you say, okay, so this is clearly a correct label for this image. So I can add these to my data set. Okay. So this is roughly the method. Again, I'm simplifying it a little bit, but this is the crux of it. And what is nice is that it scales nicely, especially when you do it in batches and so on and so on. You really kind of, you know, this is something, I'm not saying that creating ImageNet is cheap or super easy, but it's definitely manageable, as you know, as clearly demonstrated. So kind of this is what brings this, you know, bring creating this kind of large data sets as something that is actually feasible. So that's all great. The problem though is that if you think about this, you know, essentially like the way we connect or validate a given label for for an image is like it's an extreme leading question, because you know we always already present only a single candidate label for the image. And we just ask, you know, does it look reasonable or not? And also we kind of never even mention to the like annotator that, you know, there could be possibly other label that might be adequate for the image. We just ask, you know, does this object contain, does this image contain an object of class X? And that's all we ask. And if you think about it, this is again a very leading question. Like kind of, it could view, it already you should see how some of the mistakes that we kind of pointed to in this, you know, motivating example might arise in this context. Okay, so this shows that like, you know, the kind of plot thickens a little bit, and kind of, you know, this way we create a dataset might introduce some maybe undesirable biases. So now the question is, and this is what our recent work was about, trying to see, okay, so yeah, clearly this could be a problem, but is it a problem? Like kind of essentially like how much of a problem is that actually in a data set like ImageNet? Okay, so in terms of like, you know, these biases and dissipation of like what the ground truth label might be for an image, and that, you know, kind of, you know, ImageNet assumes that like this is the correct label when, you know, if you look closely, maybe it actually is, okay? And of course, you know, to be able to even, you know, do this kind of evaluation at scale, well, one thing you need to do is you need to like get a second opinion. Like you need to get some more detailed annotation for the images to even be able to confront them with ImageNetLabel. And again, like how would you do it? Well, ideally, what you would like to do is you would like to show the image to the to an annotator, and then ask them, you know, like essentially, first of all, tell them, okay, classify, you know, let's see, each object in the image, because as we see, as we have seen in the context of this, you know, of this image with the scene, is that actually there were like, you know, it was both a scene, but there were also like other like object, like, you know, acoustic guitar that was in the image. So we have to recognize that it could be actually more than one label that is valid for an image and more than one object that is in the image. So we will ideally would like to ask just, you know, like, yeah, here is an image, classify each object in this image as one of these 1,000 classes that you know, that comprise the ImageNet class set. Okay, and based on that, we will get you know, these labels, and you know, that's what you would like to do. But of course, you know, as you already said, this would be infeasible. This actually would be even less feasible than the basic, just like, you know, ask a human to assign one label to each of the images. Okay, so we can't do that. So what we do is something different. In some ways, like, we leverage what we already have. So essentially what we do is just like, we take a diverse set of ImageNet trained models. And then essentially what we do, we look at the top five prediction. Like, we pull all the top five predictions that these models return for a given image. So essentially, like, you know, like, we just look like, for each model, what are the top five most likely labels that the model believes would correspond to this image, and we just, you know, take a union over many models, and we just then narrow down it a little bit. And kind of what we get in this way is that we get a relatively short list of what I would call plausible labels for objects in the image, essentially like something that at least one of the models mentioned as a remote possibility. So now this is actually really nice, because again, now we reduce the amount of potential labels that the, you know, human annotator would need to choose from to actually just, you know, like in our case, it would be less than 10. So this becomes like manageable. This is no longer 1,000. And since we already kind of reduce this, you know, reduce this set of possible labels, what we also ask them is, again, we actually ask them to recognize like how many different objects is in the image, what are the correct labels, and also we ask them, what do you believe is the main object in this image? So even if there are multiple objects, like what would you believe is the main object here? Okay, and essentially, so that's what we did, and then we kind of aggregate over the workers, and we kind of end up with this like very detailed annotations. And again, we know what the number of objects, we know what the main object is, and for each of the objects, we actually know what are the potential labels that kind of that would make sense for that object. Okay, so this is kind of like a very refined ground truth. And you know, essentially the way we like to think about it, that this is kind of the, we are in some ways bootstrapping the original ImageNet annotation. So in some ways you can view it as like, you know, the original ImageNet annotations already like, you know, provided us with some understanding of what, you know, of what correct labels are. And now we find a way to refine them by kind of running them to this annotation task again. And kind of, I think this is a primitive that might be useful in many other contexts as well. Okay, but for now, you know, all we care about is that now we have the second opinion, actually very detailed second opinions, and now we can ask questions. Okay, so how accurate, you know, image labels are. And again, for details, you should look into the paper, but like, let me just give you a couple of highlights. So essentially, like, one thing that we're interested in particular, like, we already noticed that there are examples of this multi-object images. So images actually that contain more than one object that would correspond to a valid ImageNet class. So there is no, essentially, you know, there is no default answer here. And indeed, we actually found that 20% of the, you know, of the test images, at least like we, you know, at least of the large part of the validation set of ImageNet, like among, so essentially what we did, we tested like, I think one fifth of the whole validation set of ImageNet. And in this one field that we tested, 20% of them were test images that contain more than one object. So that's kind of a pretty large fraction. We were quite surprised by this number. So here's an example of such an image. Again, this is an extreme image because it contains actually multiple objects. Like, it's not only two, at least two, but actually multiple objects like that. But it turns out that if you ask for at least two objects in the image, 20% of test images actually is like that. And then you might ask, okay, so, but like, if there is a multi-object image, then, well, it's not clear anymore what is the correct answer, is because there is more than one, because there are at least two objects in it. And you ask, okay, so, but like clearly, like this means that, you know, there is no right answer technically, then clearly this makes the task of top one accuracy quite unfair. So how does it affect the top one accuracy of the models? And what we found, essentially, we just like to plot things that when the x-axis, we have actual, like, you know, full tested accuracy of the model, and on the y-axis, we have accuracy on the subset of images that we kind of want to zoom in and kind of look at the dependence. And essentially, like, this is for, like, each dot is a different model, so it's like a kind of, every model has some accuracy on the full tested, and it has some accuracy on the particular subset of tests that we care about. And as we see over here, there is like a big performance drop between the performance on solely single label images versus images that, you know, have actually it will be valid for them to assign more than one label. Okay, so there's kind of 10% drop in performance over there. And of course, you know, now if you know that this might be the problem, you can control for it. So essentially, like, you know, you now just kind of change the rules of the game and you count the model that is correct if it matches any of the objects in the image, because we now have labels that we know what are all the objects, so we can check if the answer that the model gave actually matches at least one object in the image. And, you know, when you control for that, then essentially this performance drop disappears. So it seems that this was really like the big driver of the performance drop on these images. Okay, so that's important to keep in mind. But, like, you know, there is something even more interesting in this context, because, okay, so now if we know that essentially, like, for some of the images there is more than one object in the image, and, you know, the ImageNet kind of insists there is only one correct label for this image, you might ask, okay, so if this was a human, the human would essentially, you know, would essentially kind of, well, have one idea of what the main or the correct object in the image is, and you would like to compare it to what ImageNet believes, you know, is the main object in the image. And what we find is that, like, it's often the kind of object that the ImageNet views as the main or the correct one is quite different to the one that humans would view as main and correct one. And this is just kind of a couple of examples. Like, in general, what we found is that ImageNet tends to focus on the kind of the most special, like the most unusual object in the picture, where, of course, humans look at, you know, at the thing that is kind of much more like the most in your face in some ways in the image. So here we just have some examples. So yeah, so in the middle we have just, you know, to us, you know, the main object here would be a suit. For ImageNet is the bow tie. And kind of it, if you think back to the way, you know, our you know, kind of the data set was created, it kind of makes sense, because kind of probably we are looking for bow tie as a search term, and then you will get an image like that that actually connects to it. But somehow, you know, essentially, like, there is, like, especially when these things disagree, the reason is that, you know, well, the, like, the data set, like, we need in this set some, you know, image of the bow tie, and we did not control for the fact that this might imply that some other object, maybe even more prominent object, is likely to appear in this, you know, image as well. Okay, so that's first observation, that actually, like, ImageNet, like, has this kind of, you know, like, it likes to, like, it likes to disagree sometimes with humans about what the main object is, and it's mostly because, you know, it's some kind of particular unusual object in the picture that it kind of, you know, like, that kind of caused this label to be chosen for this image. But then, of course, you may ask, okay, so clearly humans and ImageNet disagree what the main object is, but how do models figure it out? Like, how they decide, you know, what is the correct object to label? What is the correct label to be here? And essentially what we found is that, well, models are asked to kind of to be, like, you know, as close to ground truth as believed by ImageNet as possible. And that's what they do. So in some ways they find a way to extract these biases of the labeling, these peculiarities of the labeling. And surprisingly often they figure out that, you know, the right answer is not what a human annotator will believe that the right answer is. So second, we already see that there is kind of this, you know, discrepancy between what we as humans, we believe, you know, real object recognition would require versus what the model decides that is needed to actually pass the ImageNet test set test. Okay, so that's something to keep in mind. And finally, like, one, again, there is more biases that we have, and you can look into the paper to learn about them. But now, kind of the one more question we wanted to ask is saying, okay, so now we have a kind of like we clearly realize that, you know, maybe what ImageNet believes is correct for a given image might not be what humans would believe that is correct for the image. So, you know, actually, how about we look at the answers of the models and we try to judge them not by just comparing them to the ImageNet label, but actually by using human, you know, human annotators to decide if the given answer of a model for an image is correct or not. Okay, so essentially, it's this human-based evaluations. So what we do is just saying, okay, so we have an example image of a dog. Then we see what the model outputs for this image, and then instead of just trying to blindly compare this answer against the ImageNet label, what we do, we actually show it to the human. We ask, does this image contain object of this particular class? Okay, so kind of we ask the same question that was used for in the creation of the dataset, but now we kind of use it to validate the answer of the model. And essentially, what we find is that a few things. So first of all, we find that, as our models are improving in terms of the ImageNet test score, how reasonable the answer of our models are, according to humans, is also improving. So kind of they become better also according to the human-based evaluation. And essentially, so that's the first observation. So if you were worried that by trying to also kind of to get the right answers as believed by ImageNet, do our models actually start disagreeing with humans? It doesn't seem to be happening yet. However, what we did find is that we actually seem to be at the point, at least for a broad set of classes, in which annotators essentially can't really tell, which one is right, is the ImageNet label or the model return label. So in some ways, the answer that models provide, they seem reasonable to humans, at least if these humans are not experts and they just they are not experts in terms of recognizing different breeds of dogs. To them, these labels tend to look quite reasonable. So what it means is that saying that, we might be getting, if our baseline that we are trying to capture using ImageNet is the non-expert human annotator baseline, then it seems that we might be largely getting there already. And if we insist to kind of push our models on the ImageNet test set accuracy even further, if we insist, okay, we really want to get 100%, test accuracy on ImageNet, what might this require is that this might start to force the models to really reverse engineer all the biases and these intricacies and deficiencies of the ImageNet labeling system. And kind of we will start actually abandoning this, actual what we are after, which is this non-expert, a human annotator baseline. Okay, so again, doesn't seem we are there yet, but it also seems that we might be getting close to the point that any push further on might actually, lead us there. So in some ways, it's unclear, how useful ImageNet as a benchmark is or will be in terms of pushing our kind of, improvement of the models in terms of, object recognition in the real world. Okay, so that's a thought to ponder. And now, kind of the last thing I want to talk about is I actually want to kind of go back to this concern of adaptive overfitting that, I mentioned at the very beginning. And I just wanted to kind of talk also how the biases in the way we annotate our data can actually kind of strike back here. I mean, even try to understand, combat this adaptive overfitting problem. Okay, so remember that the question of adaptive overfitting is essentially trying to kind of avoid this, and in particular, you want to avoid this kind of p-hacking. So the problem was that we are kind of this pipeline in which we evaluate everything always on the same test set. And what might be happening that kind of our developments of models actually start overfitting to this test set as opposed to the actual, task we want to solve. And kind of people wanted to, recently people wanted to kind of understand, okay, so, how are we overfitting to the test set? Or, or maybe everything is still good. And of course the question is how would you even test whether you are overfitting to the test set? Well, the idea that was recently proposed is the idea of dataset replication, okay? Which is kind of, again, an analog of what people do in the context of, of general science, science and testing these kind of questions there. So what you do is saying, okay, So if I worry that all of my development is kind of, you know, is overfitting to the test set that everyone is using right now, well, how about just creating a new test set, like a completely fresh test set, and then see how much the performance on the original test set transfers over to the to this new test. Like, you know, ideally it would transfer completely, and then it would mean that we are not overfitting to any particular characteristic of the specific test set that we keep reusing and reusing. Okay, this is the idea, and in particular, Recht et al. Try to, you know, address this question for the question for the context in the context of ImageNet. So they create this ImageNet V2 test set. And kind of, so how, what did they do? So essentially they started with ImageNet. They wanted to replicate the kind of the test set, or, you know, to be more precise, validation set for ImageNet. And, you know, they wanted to get a fresh version of it. So what they needed to do, they kind of needed to somehow try to recreate the, you know, the creation pipeline for the original ImageNet. Okay, so essentially what they, like, long story short, like what they realized is, okay, so, you know, if you look how ImageNet is created, like what you kind of, the suggested way to recreate this pipeline is to kind of, well, source images from Flickr, which is where ImageNet source its images. And then kind of, you know, original ImageNet had some selection filtering procedure based on this notion of selection frequency. So essentially, like what they did is they did this experiment when they show an image to a, you know, to an annotator, and they ask, you know, is this an example of a class X? And they kind of look, you know, what fraction of the, you know, what fraction of humans answered yes. So this is the selection frequency of a given image. So here's an example. So here are just like different examples of the images from class Throne. And for each one of them, again, you ask, you know, what fraction of humans when they are, you know, shown this image, like, and ask, you know, does this image contain an instance of a class Throne, would say yes. Okay, and you see, like, on the left there is a selection frequency 100, so everyone agrees this is a, you know, an image of the, or like that this should be labeled as a Throne, where you have on the right, you know, there is clearly, like, many, like, majority of people actually don't believe that this is a Throne, and kind of, so in some ways you can view it as a way of controlling for the quality of label, and kind of this kind of process in some way was used in ImageNet to kind of filter out which images will make it to the actual ImageNet, you know, well, both training set and test set. Okay, so this is kind of the, you know, the like this is kind of the quantity that, you know, that Recht et al. Wanted to control to make sure that kind of they mimic the distribution of the test set as closely as possible. So what they did is essentially, like, they, you know, they took new batch of Flickr examples, they measured, you know, selection frequency for them, and they also measured selection frequencies for the original test set. Okay, and then what they did is essentially, like, you know, once they kind of, you, like, they kind of read off the distribution of selection frequency for this original image test set, and then they essentially, like, what they did, they created a new test set in a way that matches by important sampling the, you know, the distribution of the selection frequencies of the original test set. So it's like they wanted to have this new Flickr images be created in such a way that, you know, this measured selection frequencies matches in terms, like, as a distribution. Okay, and that's how kind of, like, they selected which of the Flickr images should actually constitute the new test. Okay, so that's so that's what they did. And now what they did observe, so now they have this new test set, and, you know, would like to see essentially, like, how does the performance of, you know, of the models transfers over to this new test set. And what they discover a couple of things, but what they discover, one thing that we want to focus on, is that actually there is significant accuracy drop, that, like, between 11 to 14% of accuracy drop in terms of the performance on the new test set versus the old test. So, you know, it seems that, well, the performance has a performance drop. And, you know, you might ask, you know, like, the first conclusion might be, okay, well, you know, essentially, like, clearly we, in some ways, you know, like, you know, our models are actually, you know, very, like, sensitive to the intricacies of the test set. And once we change the test set, you know, kind of the performance drop. Like, the important point to make, though, is that, like, this drop is monotonical. So essentially, like, better models on the original test set are still better on this new test set. Just that everything roughly got, you know, there is a, just a uniform drop in the performance. So there is kind of seems to be something that is harder for, you know, for the models when they need to deal with this new test set. And kind of the question is what? And kind of this is something that we kind of got very intrigued on and actually looked into. And what we realized that, again, like, that actually this hardness might actually stem not just from the vulnerability of the models to kind of variation in the distribution, but actually from instances of statistical bias. Okay, so essentially, like, what is statistical bias is, and I don't want to go too deeply into this, but, like, you know, you can take a look into the, like, at the paper to learn more. But essentially, like, the kind of the root of a problem stems from the fact that, like, the goal of, you know, of this kind of matching procedure, like the, like, when you know, Rect et al. Were creating the new test set, the way they did it is just they wanted to take the Flickr images for which the measured selection frequencies matches the distribution of measured selection frequencies of the original test set. Okay, and this sounds like a great idea, except the problem is that we actually, like, selection frequency is this abstract concept. It corresponds to showing it to, like, infinity of people and measuring the fraction of them that says yes. But, like, we never have access to actual selection frequencies. What we have access to is just this noisy estimate of them, because we just shown it to, like, a few workers, and kind of we want to, like, essentially we average the answer. This is our empirical unbiased estimate of the selection frequencies. And kind of, sorry, and kind of the point that turns out to be happening is that, you know, even though these estimates as hat are actually unbiased estimators of the true selection frequencies, just matching this, you know, empirical estimates one by one, like essentially one to one, like taking them at their face value, and then kind of that's how we, you know, figure out how to match the distributions of this, like, if you match the distribution of this empirical selection frequencies, this actually does not correspond to matching the selection frequencies of the underlying true, like, of the underlying true selection frequencies. Okay, so essentially, like, what happens is that, you know, again, even though the empirical selection frequency is an unbiased estimator of, you know, of selection frequencies, essentially, if we want to think about, you know, for a given empirical value of selection frequency, what is the most likely true selection frequency that corresponds to it? Well, the answer to that question actually depends on whether I was measuring, you know, measuring this answer on the original ImageNet versus the new source images. And if you don't account for this fact, then essentially you will, you know, you will introduce a systematic bias, like essentially a statistical bias in the process. And essentially, you know, what we did then is that once we realized that there is bias, we essentially figure out you know, statistical modeling tools to try to correct for this. And once we did that, and again, this is just long story short, and we kind of needed to run an independent experiment because we just needed to get, you know, like essentially more refined approximations of the of this empirical selection frequencies corresponding to different numbers of workers. And once we did that, what we realized is actually once you adjust for this bias, this gap of 11 on 14 that was kind of observed by, you know, Rect et al., then essentially on our data, like, it seems to shrink significantly. So suggests that there is actually, like, you know, this bias does play a role, and actually quite significant role, that kind of, you know, that in terms of responsibility for the hardness of the new test. Okay, and again, like, we just actually did this in a couple of ways, and, you know, the conclusions seem to be stable. And kind of, you know, the point here was that, you know, essentially, like, you know, sometimes things that, you know, like, whenever we think about distributions, especially high dimensional distributions like ImageNet, and we try to do some kind of modeling on them, kind of we have to be very careful, you know, what we control for, because again, biases are abound and they can really skew our conclusions and actually the metrics that we use to drive, you know, the performance of our models. Okay. So that's all I have to say. So let me just conclude with some takeaways. So I think the key takeaway I have here is that, you know, what models do and do not learn is really not always clear. Like, kind of we have our belief that, you know, that that's what models learn, but this really is not true, that, like, it's always clear. And in particular, like, when we are kind of focusing on improving performance on a given benchmark, we should really think about, like, what this benchmark means, like, what kind of bias is introduced, and kind of whether this is okay or not okay, or maybe we should control for them. And in particular, we should really think about what are our benchmarks, like, what are the benchmarks we are trying to, like, you know, optimize when we want to think about robustness. Essentially, how does it affect the robustness of the techniques and models that emerge from it? So yeah, so as I said, models are affected by different biases of the world and of our data pipelines. Again, every pipeline introduces some biases, so, you know, it's unavoidable. But the question is, you know, can you identify at least some of them and then account for them. So kind of these biases do not skew kind of the usefulness of the conclusions and techniques that you develop for the original motivating task that you actually want to solve, as opposed to the benchmark you end up focusing on. Okay, so moving forward, you know, the question will be, of course, what other biases do models learn from the data? You know, how do we train our models to kind of, that allows the models to control for these biases and mitigate the impact? And essentially, like, you know, how, this is the ultimate question, like, how do we measure performance on kind of, if there is like a, this, you know, very diverse and, you know, a very complex question that, like, you know, real world object recognition, like, how do we kind of project it on some tangible benchmarks in a way that essentially we, like, progress on this benchmark really drives forward the progress on the, you know, on this, you know, motivating task, and of course, like, what even the performance of the motivating task really means, and kind of that's a question that, again, as our tools get better in terms of benchmarks that we already have, you know, is this kind of question that we need to start thinking about, you know, like, what is the next benchmark, like, after ImageNet, what should be the next benchmark we should try to formulate to just make sure that, again, the models that we get, they really like get closer to achieving the real goal, which is the, you know, real world object recognition. Okay, that's all I have to say. If you want to read more about our work, you know, here is a, you know, a URL of our research blog that has all the work that I discussed